Hey guys, I think we have a candidate for like most beautiful bike of 2019. I love this thing. I mean, it's just such a cool vintage look, matching leather on the grips, on this controller bag, battery bottle, it's kind of unique. Saddle, I'm used to seeing these sort of from Brooks. This one is branded Retro S, but they actually call this model the Retro R. That's the Retro S, apparently. And the leather is a little bit darker on this one, but just beautiful. Look at how it matches these custom, kind of a chocolate milk look on these tires. These are fat tires, but a very unique size, 24-inch diameter by 3-inch width. I'm so used to seeing 4-inch width. This is just a lot on this bike that's so custom and special. And then if we look at the pressure here, it says up to 65 down to 40. So 40 to 65, that's weird. Like, I'm used to seeing 5 to 30 PSI on these fat tires. You can drop them really low and ride on sand or snow. So this really seems more like a road-oriented fat tire. I think it just matches the aesthetic of this bike. Look at these very, very thick 10-gauge spokes. I'm used to only seeing up to 12, and usually it's only on the rear wheel to handle the forces of like a hub motor. And this does have a hub motor, 500 watt. They say up to 90 newton meters of torque, which I'm like, I don't know, that's a lot. Normally, like motors and stuff give you 50 newton meters of torque, and that's about what they said for this one. This is a 250 watt motor, a little bit lighter. That's probably 7 pounds or something, and this is probably like 9 pounds. It's a fat bike specific, a little bit wider to support those wider rims. Just beautiful. Look at this stainless steel frame. Kind of a double tube design to allow you to hang that battery, keeping the weight low and center. Beautiful, like kind of a stainless steel bottle as well, and it even says BPA free, so don't worry, guys. We took this off a minute ago to weigh it, and you can open up this cap, and there's actually a little bit of space in there, so you could hide some extra money or a key or something in there while you're riding. And then, of course, they've got this beautiful rack. It's a little bit more stylish than functional, in my opinion. The tubing gauge is a little bit thicker. It's not the standard gauge that's narrower for the clip-on racks. It doesn't have like a rectangular yep window. It's got these cool like chevrons here, but it does say 25 kilogram max weight. That's about 55 pounds. Not too bad. And then with those nice big tires, you get stability, you get a little bit of comfort, but 24 inches lowering the frame, so the standover height on this one's actually a little bit lower than on that. It only comes in one frame size, high step design with these nice flowing lines, just really beautiful that way. If you were someone who wanted a little bit more comfort than just the tires, you could swap out this 28.6 millimeter seat post, and you could get like a little suspension post. And they do sell one. I think it's the SR Suntour NCX suspension post. You know, maybe it's like $100 or something, and that'll give you a little bit more comfort, and they sell it in silver. Okay, so for me, that's kind of nice. You keep everything matching like this. You got silver crank arms. I think these ones were 165, so they're a little bit shorter, and that raises the clearance a little bit since the frame is lower with the 24-inch wheels. Welgo aluminum alloy platform pedals, also silver. The narrow versions, I kind of prefer the big fat ones myself. My feet aren't super big, but see how these are a little narrower? It might help you squeeze through cars or through doorways, and that could be useful because these battery bags, while they are removable, you kind of got all these quick disconnect points and stuff you have to mess around with, and they don't lock to the frame. So it's not quite as convenient as like a battery that just clicks onto the frame. It has a key locking core. These are a little bit more vulnerable to me. Also, the leather, I mean, this is a brand new bike. It looks beautiful. It's a sunny day, but over time, if it gets dried out, or maybe you're stepping over the bike and it gets scratched, and then it starts to crack over time, there's a little bit of weight hanging on these. This top one's supported by that secondary top tube, but the bottom one, you know, look at these two little leather straps right here. That, to me, is a big red flag, because this is fairly heavy. I think it was 6.5 pounds or something like that. Same battery capacity, by the way, lithium ion battery. That bottle, the same battery capacity as in this bag. And they kind of recycled that bag design for the controller over here. So things got flip-flopped a little bit. 48 volts, 8 amp hours, 384 watt hours, so just below 400. That is not a ton, considering it's a 500 watt motor and a bike that's like 67.9 pounds, a little bit heavier. That's a 50 pound bike. So to me, you know, there's some question marks about range on this thing. Yes, it's efficient. You got those smooth tires and stuff. You got the higher PSI, which is nice. but you only have a single speed drivetrain. So if you got caught on this thing and the battery was completely dead and you were trying to go up a hill, there's only that one gear ratio, and it might be a struggle. That's sort of what I'm thinking. We got a dog who's like excited about this too. So maybe we should just walk the bikes that way. While we do, this is a 2-amp charger that it comes with. Same charger for both bikes. If you look at that charging point, it kind of looks like a Radio Shack charger or something. I'm not used to seeing this. It's not quite as fast as some of the newer chargers. But, you know, at 1.3 pounds, it's compact. It fit into a backpack. And Sam's just going to toss that in my bag. Thank you, buddy. I think it freewheels fairly efficiently, but I can actually see the gearing down there in that shaft drive. Maybe a little bit of friction there, a little bit of a noise when Sam was riding this earlier. It was kind of a sound. So, kickstand, love that it has one. Don't love that it's in the center of the frame because you get pedal lock. So not only does it scratch up the kickstand, which is silver to match, beautiful, but you can't back it up easily. So like if you're in a garage situation, you're backing your bike up, there you go, you get the pedal lock and you have to kind of pick the frame up and spin the wheels a little bit. Love that they've got these 100 millimeter wide, beautifully matched steel fenders. So they're not stainless steel like the rest of the frame. I think, you know, if they get scratched or something, you get a little bit of rust over time. Even stainless steel over time get a little bit of rust. There might be some vibration dampening qualities because of the stainless steel frame. And then we have a stainless steel housing on that headlight with a glass yellow lens. Just really, just beautiful. These are the wire wraps I was talking about. There's this black curly ones and then a matching leather one. You know, picture communicates 1,000 words, right? So you're hopefully you're getting an idea as I walk around this bike that this fender support arm is bent so it goes around that disc brake caliper right there. These are mechanical disc brakes, 160 millimeter rotors, front and rear. And that's one of the areas where I was going pretty fast. These bikes, you can kind of unlock the display system and get into the top speed setting. I was going like 25 miles per hour, pedal assist and throttle mode. That's fast. And then when you brake, it was a longer braking time because they aren't hydraulic. There's going to be a little bit more hand effort required, especially for the rear one because the cable goes all the way back here. But the way they're positioned, it sort of tilts the wire down. So hopefully a lot of times I'll see e-bike brakes down here to make room for rack struts and stuff, and then water can run into the housing. So in this case, it seems like it would run out and it would actually be pretty clean. Again, look at that nice support arm for that fender bent around. It's just a beautiful, beautiful setup. We've got a horizontal dropout with some little torque arm washers in there. Hopefully that's all right. Maybe that's part of being a steel frame. They don't have an external torque arm like we see on some of the really powerful motors or some of the other bikes I've reviewed recently. And I like that the rack is just built right onto the frame. So it's sort of a style piece, but it is fairly functional. Maybe you get some leather bags that hang over the top. That would be a really good choice. Or maybe a little saddle bag that could hang off of these tabs on the back. I don't think I've talked about the price point on this one. $26.99 versus $24.99 on this one. So for $200 more, you get yourself a fat bike with a much more powerful motor, an integrated light, and then still got these nice sweatback handlebars. But in this case, it's a fixed stem versus over there we had a quill stem with adjustable angle. To me, this bike's awesome. I really, really like this bike. There are some points of sensitivity, as I mentioned. I'm concerned about how well this leather is going to hold up. I mean, even right now, it's kind of straining a little bit, I feel, to hold that bottle really close to the fender right there. Could maybe touch a little bit, but they have made the frame longer, I think, so you won't get toe strikes. Pedal it forward like that. So if your foot is down like here and then you're turning, you could get a toe strike on that fender. But because they've made the frame long, I really don't see that happening too much with this. It's fairly well thought out, and it seems like a purpose-built frame. See, there's like a channel here, so it hides the wires. Some of the other wires are just going through the bags. I guess it's on the other one, there's actually wires going through the frame. So this one, most of the wires are up top. Sam, you want to chime in with any thoughts here? By the way, this is Sam, Electric Bicycle Center. He carried both of these bikes, and he's met the guys from the company. Can you tell me a little bit about the company?
Yeah, Nicholas came down. He's out of Concord, California.
Yeah.
And I want to just reference my personal experience on these bikes. I've never ridden an electric bike that got so much attention as that bike right there. I mean, I was going to the bank and to the post office one day, and I had 8 people comment on the bike.
Wow.
And that was only like in a couple miles.
Did they say, hey, money bags? Was that the comment you got?
No. They were just like, cool, different. And I was hearing words like steampunk and,
okay.
You know, retro and cool. And that is that, they didn't, and some people didn't realize it was an electric bike, quite honestly. Oh. They're like, what's with the wine jug down there, you know?
Nice. Yeah.
It's definitely got a unique look to it.
That's funny you say that. I was just thinking it looks, you're kind of blinging. You're on the way to the bank and, who knows, but it's definitely stylish. How do you feel about how it rides and pedaling with the shaft drive? And but P.S., the shaft drive, to me, it's kind of unnecessary, except I am wearing pants, so it's not going to get snagged. It adds a little bit of weight, but it's not going to fall off. Hopefully, it's more reliable than a
lower
chain.
Maintenance. You don't have to worry about getting greasy with your chain lubing and adjusting your derailleur. It's a shaft drive. And how many electric bikes are out there with a shaft drive?
Shaft.
I bet it's a pretty low number. So
yeah, it's probably.
If you're looking for something with shaft drive, this is one to consider.
This is such a unique setup just in so many ways that for me, the shaft drive is just like, what? And a shaft drive? Like, I've never seen any chrome bikes like this that are.
Yeah, that polished stainless steel looks pretty cool.
Yeah, beautiful. What other thoughts do you have before I get into the display panel?
So for me, it's got 24-inch rims, which could bring your seat down a little bit lower than traditional maybe 26-inch.
Uh-huh.
And that seat's a little bit hard. You got to break it in,
Good
but
point.
Once you've broken that in, it might get a little bit more comfortable. I talked to Nicholas about that. And I think it really flows well with the retro look from front to back. They did a good job. It reminds me of something from like around 1910, like an old Flying Merkle or a Thor or a Henderson motorcycle. These are old vintage bikes that were pre-World War II. Made here in America. It's got that old look to it,
It does. It does. I'm glad I got a friend here who remembers all those old.
Well, I'm a bike guy, so.
I know. Right. There's something really cool about this bike, guys. And to be honest with you, the price, while not as affordable as some of the other bikes that are like, I haven't really heard of this brand before, the California Bicycle Factory. Again, they started, it sounded like 2009 in Guangzhou, China, and then in 2010, they opened up an office in Concord, which is Northern California. So that's a while, and they sell regular bikes too. They said they have like 86 dealers, but they also have a website, so they might sell direct. Said they had a 1-year warranty with 2 years on the motor and battery. That's pretty good. That's, kind of impressive to me, and be able to sell this through a dealer, and it works, right? Like, yeah, the battery's not the highest capacity, but it's a fun bike to cruise around in the neighborhoods and stuff, and you maybe could take it on little trails and stuff and have some stability or comfort.
Give it a test ride, Check out one of those dealers and ask them to stock it so you can give it a try.
That's the other thing. Sometimes there are dealers out there where it's like the website says the dealer carries it. Maybe they have a relationship, but it was neat that you actually had these on the show floor. And I'm calling out Sam and his shop because it's one of the cool places to go to see a lot of brands.
The bottom line is if you stock it on the store and if it sells, you keep it in stock.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't move very many of them, you move on to the next manufacturer for me.
How long have you held these?
These are brand new for us. We've only had them for about 3 or 4 months now. So
okay.
We haven't had them on the showroom floor for very long.
Okay.
But they do grab attention on the showroom floor.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I can see why. Okay, you guys, so we talked about all the stats and stuff. I'm going to show you how this display works. It's not easy to see. I'm going to go up into the shadow there because it's just not the brightest display. There is a brightness setting inside. You can sort of adjust and turn up the brightness. But even then, it's not the world's brightest. And we're on a really beautiful day here in Fullerton, California. So we hold the M button. There it goes, comes to life. I try to use my shadow to, try to get out of the way. I'm trying my best, guys. At the top, it has battery percentage as well as battery capacity, 5 ticks. And I'm just going to try to go right into the settings here first and try to make this as bright as possible. So I'm holding the up and down, and I go to brightness. Yeah, the default is on 2, and we want to take it up to 5. So hopefully that's a little bit better for you guys. So let's go back to the main readout. So battery percentage, great that it's so precise. Speed, it's in kilometers per hour right now, but we can change that to miles per hour in the settings. Assist level, it defaults to 1, and the throttle is live. Even on assist level 0, the throttle is live. So be careful if you're loading this or you're hopping on and you bump it, you could take off, and this is a more powerful motor, so just be careful. Especially the 48 volt system, it's a little more efficient with the electricity and a little bit more kick to it than if it was a 36. So power, that's watts, so it will kind of go up as you ride. Odometer, there we go, clock, that's it. I noticed that if you hold the up arrow, see, it changes, it like inverts, and you get a black background, and that's so it's not quite as distracting if you're riding at night. And that's what gets that front light going. Look at that, beautiful. It's more of a B-scene kind of headlight. I haven't tested this at night, but it's just not quite as like bright as some of the other commuter lights I've seen. I'm gonna go ahead and turn that off. Now if we hold the up and down keys again, we'll get into the settings. There wasn't any kind of walk mode or any other things that I discovered there, but there's so much to choose from back here. So system, I'm gonna go from metric to imperial, so miles per hour, since I'm in the US right now. Auto off, 5 minutes, scene, digits, battery percentage, clock settings, and then down here, basic. So I'm gonna go into all these other menus. Look at this. So wheel size, battery, start password. So even though you can't really lock the battery to the frame, you can lock the bike with a password. I think that's kind of neat if you live around kids, or maybe that you're just parking it outside. And frankly, that's one of the question marks for me. Oh, and look how the bottles kind of tip into the side right now. So to me, this is a big point of concern for me. I'd look at like reinforcing that or just really taking good care of the leather. But let's say that you can't fit that in your home. You just don't have room in your garage, or maybe it's getting really cold or really hot in your garage and you want to protect your battery. A little bit of extra work, like taking that off each time. And you know, with such a big bike, it's sort of like, okay, how do you manage the battery? There it is. So look at that speed limit. And so I'm going to take this up to all the way to like, I think 60 is the highest it goes, but the highest I was actually able to ride on this bike. Oh, it gives it even higher than 60. Just because it says that number doesn't mean it's going to go that fast. The real top speed is about 25 miles per hour. Gosh, 90, 100, okay, 100 kilometers per hour. That's the top speed. So the motor will still try to help you, even though we got, look at this. It's just such a friendly day with the dogs are getting excited. Current limit, so 17 amps. Maybe we could, I wonder if we can, no, that's, come on. A little bit of a delay here. 18 amps, so 20 amps. I'm taking this all the way to the top. Power limit, 1,500 watts. Okay, so we're just like, you're gonna see how powerful this thing can be. I'm gonna be riding on the street. I do have my motorcycle license, but technically we're turning this into a moped right now. And in some ways that's cool, but in other ways, if you're riding on bike paths or if you're riding, you know, off-road, you might be turning this into like a class 4 or like unclassified e-bike. By default, I think it's 20 mile per hour class 2 because it does have that throttle. Start mode 0, driver mode, start strength. There's just a ton of stuff. Next page, this thing is so deep. Throttle level, clock, key, anti-jam. I don't even know what that means. Exit. So 3 layers deep. Okay. Here we go. Sam.
A lot of information there, Corey.
It's nonstop. I mean, there was just a gentleman in Sam's store. He's like, "You're the e-bike guy." I was like, "Yep, that's me." And he was like, "Thanks for going so deep, because like I want all the details." Are you fan? Are you? You recognize me? Are you okay being on camera? Thank you. Yeah, it's the same shirts for the past 6 years, guys. I'm really making them last. That bike, which one is that?
The Magnum.
The Magnum. They do a good job. Yeah, those guys invited me out and stuff. Are you thinking about getting e-bikes? Yeah.
We actually have.
You're upgrading.
I bought one from him a couple years ago.
No, I've had customers, and I did this delivery to a gal, and her brother was wondering what she was doing. It was like 3 o'clock in the morning, and she was in her bedroom, like watching Court's videos. And he's like, "What are you doing at 3 o'clock in the morning on the internet?" You know. It's like, "I'm watching Court's videos."
Well, thanks, you guys. I'm doing my best. In this case, I just wanted to show these lights. See how they kind of blink a little bit. They're motion sensing. And then the display panel, now that it's a little bit dark. That's it. I hope you guys find an awesome bike. And thanks for the props. I'm glad you enjoyed it. Rock on.
Thank you for all those great reviews we've been watching for a
minute. Aw, you're welcome. Take care.
Thank you.
We're at 20 minutes right now. I haven't even hopped on the bike. But I mean, this is our chance, right? Like, when am I going to see this bike again? You might not have it at your local dealer. Perhaps they can get it for you, but they don't stock it. My goal is just to be thorough.
Absolutely. And there was a lot of information on that display, which a lot of other bikes don't have half that ability to switch and change and tweak.
They don't even let you in. So is there any other thoughts before I take a quick little...
Let's do it. Let's go.
Okay, I'm going to go all the way up to assist level 5. and then just show you the motor. Kind of notice that, like, I think when I'm not pedaling that happens, so it must be like part of the shaft drive. And even though we have those fairly stable big fat tires, they're kind of a smaller radius, like the 24 inch, and that means like a lower attack angle, so you might feel the bumps a little bit more and get some rattle. I'm also not feeling super comfortable no hands on this bike for whatever reason. Like, it's just, it feels like maybe the headset's a little bit tight or something. So I don't know, can't really comment, but I felt a little bit more stable on the other bike, the Retro S. There we go. Pretty nice seating position though, very upright, comfortable, it's feeling good. Okay guys, from here you can see that shaft drive. Normally I'd be talking about the chainring size and the gearing in the back, but there's nothing to say. Feels pretty comfortable around 16, 18 miles per hour. And that's also how the Retro S feels with the bigger wheels. With the smaller wheels here, there might be, maybe it's a little bit lower speeds where this feels comfortable. I don't know, it's kind of an interesting situation because you can raise that top speed, and in which case it turns into kind of a scooter and you're going to be beating eggs if you're trying to keep up. The shorter 165mm crank arms, you got square tapered spindles, so it's not a fancy like mountain bike higher end stuff, it's kind of basic, but unique. And you can see the gearing there a little bit, and you might hear some of that like ring that we were talking about. It didn't do that on the Retro S, so maybe it's just this one, perhaps it's the plastic or the gears, I don't really know. You know, I didn't feel a ton of drag. I meant to call out, like, the motor power cable goes down, and it has a pretty sharp bend here to get around this, shaft housing. That's going to protect it, almost like a derailleur guard would, but it does have that sharp bend, so just be careful. You know, you don't want to have that break, because then your motor isn't going to work. And the motor had this like DKY label on it, but it might be a Bafang fat tire motor. So anyway, 500 watt, let's do it. I'll be in the highest level of assist here, pedal assist 5. Probably here there's a little bit of a delay in the start and the stop. I have no idea where the cadence sensor is, it's not really visible, so maybe that means it's protected pretty well. I mean, it's obviously working. This time I'm going to do throttle, so I'm just going to coast. Again, it kicks on smoothly, so maybe it offers 90 newton meters of torque, but to me that seems like it's kind of misleading, right? It's got a nice smooth ramp. Yes, it's a bigger, kind of powerful motor. The smaller wheel diameter gives you a mechanical advantage, but don't expect this thing to just like a rocket ship. It's actually pleasant that it's smooth, given that this is more of a neighborhood, kind of a cruiser type of bike. Okay, you remember I said we unlocked everything, right? Like watts, top speed, and the fastest that it would go right there was 24.5 miles per hour. I'm 135 pounds, and this is a flat street, no wind or anything, so that's probably the fastest you could expect this to go. And again, in which case it sort of changes what type of bike this is, how it's classified. Hope that helps you out. Got the brakes, the mechanical disc brakes. For a heavier bike like this, about 68 pounds, you know, that was one of the areas. It's like the brakes could be upgraded a little bit, and maybe the headset just needs to be. Oh, look at the bottle, right? That's the thing. I'm gonna have Sam hop on this now. Are you good for that?
Yeah, let's do it.
Boom. Let's go, guys. Hopping on the Retro S. Okay, he's got an assist level 1. He's probably shooting throttle. There he goes. Wait up. Looking good, dude. You turn on the headlight. Oh boy. There we go. I just think that thing looks so rad. Sweet. Okay, let's pull it over.
It's all good.
Yeah, very rad. Guys, I think that's about it. I'll have all the specs back at the website. I try to memorize them and say it all on camera, but there's other stuff like minimum saddle height, standover height, width, length. And I welcome your feedback. Like, maybe you've seen this bike before, you've test ridden it, or there's something I got wrong. Just let me know, right? Like, the idea is to get the best information out there, trying to be objective, hanging out with a friend, having a wonderful day.
Get out there, be safe, have fun. We'll see you out there.
He said it. See you next time, guys.